you didn't already know.
We'll start with you, Ms. Miller.
I'm Gail Miller. I am on the town council of the big city of Swetsonville. We are the blue light right now.
Town council? Anybody have a town?
Yes, they have town council. I'm the only female on it. I'm the only person under age 65 on it.
I'm John Haynes. I'm just a private citizen here to learn as much as I can.
I'm John Brooks, and I'll just ditto that.
I'm Daniel Hawk, and just trying to put names and faces together that I've learned so much about.
I'm Herbie Barber. Just like this gentleman, I just want to learn something.
I'm Rhonda Peebles. I'm a retired teacher. I've been in Alamance County and Graham since 1987.
I'm Kelly Inman. I'm Assistant Director at Social Services.
And Kelly will be presenting today. Yes.
I'm Terry Johnson. I'm sheriff here in Alamance County.
And I'm Tony Cox, and I'm a private citizen. I'd rather be working, but some people don't want me to work, so therefore I'm here.
My name is David Sproul. I'm the Soil and Water Conservation District Supervisor of Alamance County. Also, I'm on the Social Service Board of Alamance County. Also, I was appointed last week ago on the Planning Board of Alamance County. And I'm just here trying about the budget, learning about the budget.
I'm Jim Brooks. I'm just a local resident here, just trying to learn a little bit.
Andy Stevens. I'm moving here from Guilford County. Be a regular burn this out here pretty soon. So. End of the month.
Stacy Saunders, Health Director. Stacy will be presenting this to you.
I'm Ravi Balan. I live in Methven. I am also privileged to serve on the Alamance County Planning Board and Historic Properties Commission as well. So I'm looking forward to learning about the county operations.
Lydia Hodges, I'm the Planning Board.
I'm Tony Rise. I serve on the school board.
And I'm turning over to Craig Hoodycutt, our county manager.
All right. Again, thank you again for coming back out. We appreciate your interest in Alamance County. And we're going to do it a little bit different today than we did on Tuesday. And Tuesday, we gave you a lot of nuts and bolts about what the county does. A lot of numbers. We talked budget. We went over departmental numbers, such as how many calls we do in EMS, such as how many calls that we do from our central communications. So that PowerPoint will be online, and also the budget information that we did will be online. But today I thought it would be more important, since we're really only doing two sessions, is for you to hear directly from our departments and our largest departments, and really it's the Sheriff's Department, Department of Social Services, and the Health Department. And then I've also gotten Libby Hodges, who is our Planning Director, to talk about our strategic plan that we're doing in the county. So Libby will kind of wrap things up with that. But this will give you a little bit more in depth about certain things that we do, and these are really the largest departments that we have, budget-wise, as well as what they do with respect to delivery of services. So with that said, we'll let Stacy go first. She's actually missing a meeting right now, and so I told her I'd let her go first, but we appreciate the work Stacy's done. Stacy's been health director for a little over a year.
That's right.
She was the health education supervisor before that, and been here 7 years?
Almost eight, yeah.
8 years now, so, but we appreciate you coming. Thanks, Stacy.
You know, if it's okay with y'all, I'll just sort of come this way. If that's all right here. Unless you can't hear me well enough, and I'll be able to, I can project a little bit better too. So one, thank you for inviting me to come and talk about the health department. It sounds like you're learning a little bit about local government and how all the departments interact with each other and what that governance sort of looks like. And so I'm just going to go over a brief overview of what the health department is and what our mission is, and talk to you a little bit about just the annual report from 2015 to give you an idea, a snapshot of what services we do and how many we do. So with that said, as the local health department, we are charged with protecting and improving the health of everyone in Alamance County, including from the very young to the very old, from the very poor to the very rich. Our services are divided up into individual and personal types of services and community services. So within the health department, which is located in the same building as the Department of Social Services at 319 Grand Hopedale Road, and if you ever want to visit, please let us know. I'll be glad to give you a tour. We do what we call individual services. Most of our staff is in that building, although we have three campuses just because of the way the county is sort of set up. In that one building, we do mostly individual service type things. So kind of like any doctor's office you would go to. We do prenatal care. We do family planning, women's health, child health, immunizations, STDs, nutrition counseling. We also have behavioral health. We house one licensed clinical social worker because for us at the health department, we understand that just because we fix what's physically ailing you doesn't unless we take care of the emotional and social piece of it as well. So there's also wraparound services and case management is what we call that. And then on the community side, you all are probably most familiar with environmental health, though you might not call it that. But if you've ever eaten at a restaurant, we've been there inspecting that restaurant, making sure sanitation is good and that they're doing things to protect you from getting sick. If you've ever stayed in a hotel, we've been there before you got there, making sure that everything there is okay. If you have children or grandchildren that go to childcare, we've been there before you got there to make sure everything's okay. If you live out in the country and have a well or septic tank, we've been involved in your life. Because we have inspectors who go out there and make sure everything's okay before you move into your home so that you don't wake up one morning and have raw sewage out in your backyard. So in addition to that, the community piece is also health education and community outreach. So we're out in neighborhoods doing different types of behavioral health or health education. Sometimes you might have seen us do a health fair. Those aren't as common as they used to be. Now we're doing much more intensive evidence-based type of strategies within neighborhoods. So really looking at a neighborhood and looking at the needs that they have or a part of our community and what needs they have and really targeting those interventions so that we can have the biggest bang for our buck for the people in that community. And we also do communicable disease monitoring and surveillance. So if you haven't gotten a communicable disease lately, public health has been involved in that because one of the things we're always looking at is how do we prevent that from happening. One of those things is environmental health. They're highly involved in communicable disease monitoring and surveillance because as they inspect restaurants, they're always part of what they're looking for is hand washing, sanitation, all those sort of things. So the work that we do actually prevents you from ever seeing a communicable disease outbreak. Not to say that we don't sometimes have them. Some of you might have lived through pertussis in 2012 with us, and we were the agency and abating that, monitoring that, doing surveillance on pertussis, and helping prevent the spread of pertussis throughout the county. We do have a governance board called the Board of Health. We have mandated positions on that board by statute, and they oversee our policies, our services. They approve our budget, but we also have a very close relationship with the Board of Commissioners and with our county manager, as quite a bit of our county, our budget comes from county appropriated dollars, and so the Board of Commissioners also are involved in our budget process. And some of our services are mandated by statute. That's maybe a little different from some other departments you might hear about, because our North Carolina general statutes have a lot actually around public health, which is keep the community safe. And our work involves not just us. So when you see that building at 319 North Grand Hopedale Road, it's not that public health just happens in that one space. We actually have one building at 209 Grand Hopedale Road, which is environmental health, and a building at McKinney Street, which is our children's dental center. But aside from those buildings, much of what we do and the folks that we work with are outside that building. When I spoke to the commissioners the other day at their meeting and they proclaimed April Public Health Month, I took a moment to say thank you to all the other county employees and our partners who are not a part of the county system who are a part of public health. Our public health family is quite broad. that when we do work, it involves more than just the folks who are in that building with me. It involves the school system. It involves law enforcement. It involves EMS. It involves United Way, the hospital, consumers just like you. All of those people are involved in public health and have a public health role. And what Scott has put up for you is just a snapshot of 2015, and sort of this is the annual report that will be presented to the Board of Health in just a couple of weeks of what we did in 2015. And usually this report is included in what we call the state of the health, the state of the county health report that we do in between years that we're not doing the community health assessment. But this year we did what's called the community health assessment, and because of that we have a standalone annual report this year. And if you haven't taken a look at the community health assessment, I encourage you to do so. You can find it on our website, and that is an assessment that's done every 3 years using data, primary data from you all, from the community, to tell us what the most important health issues are for Alamance County. And then we use that community assessment to drive our work. It doesn't only drive, not only does it drive our work, it drives the work of the hospital, United Way, Healthy Alamance, and to a certain degree other community partners in Alamance County. So this is just a snapshot from 2015. And what you can see is, from where I was talking about for environmental health, in last year alone, they did over 2,000 food and lodging inspections. We are at 100% of inspections. If you take a look around at other counties, they do not reach 100% of inspections within the county. So you are well protected. Folks are making sure they get out there. Folks are, our inspectors make sure that the people working in restaurants are well trained, they're using good hygiene, they're taking care of you. In addition, there were investigations for health hazards within food and lodging of about 173. Almost 600 water samples collected. We also have a hand in rabies vaccination or rabies control, not only from a clinical standpoint with our nurses and our providers at the health department, but our environmental health staff is also involved in that. And we actually have a low-cost rabies vaccination clinic coming up. I believe it's April 30th, but I can get the exact date for you. And then on that green section, you can see some of the things. All three of these programs have to do with children and very young children. Care coordination for children is a Medicaid savings program run by the state that comes down to the local health departments for children 0 to 5. And in last year alone, we had 13,000 contacts with those children and making sure that they have the services that they need so that they can be ready, not only in the 0 to 5 years range, but also getting them ready for kindergarten readiness in a way that we're looking at social, emotional, physical health. Our children's dental clinic saw over 7,500 children last year, or had over 7,500 visits last year. And then the WIC program, which is Women, Infants, and Children's, is a supplemental food program, not to be confused with what Kelly might talk to you about, which is SNAP. This is around pregnant women, newborns, and children up to the age of 5. And if I can scroll down. And the rest of it's just a snapshot of our clinical services. You can see that we did over 18,000 lab tests, almost 2,700 HIV tests administered. We had 2,200 STD visits last year, over 3,300 family planning visits, almost 4,000 attorney visits, and over 150 child health visits. We gave out almost 1,700 flu vaccines, and 4,700 immunizations in total were given. And within the community health piece, we had almost 1,800 health education encounters and $15,000 in grants. Usually that number's a lot higher, but we had a lot of transition. I used to be the health education supervisor and then promoted to the health director, so we had a little lag there. That number will be increasing exponentially in this coming year as we just received two large grants. And over here, just to sort of break down just the revenue piece, that we have revenue that comes in from county, state, federal funds, and then the fees that we actually produce within the health department. So in addition to county appropriated dollars, we make
our own revenue through some of the services that we have. We also receive revenue from state programs and from the Division of Public Health, and some money through federal that comes down to us. And then there's just a list of the folks who are on our Board of Health currently. Any questions?
Any questions for Stacy?
Why is the private sector not picking up all these contacts?
Well, I'm sorry, say that.
Why are these, like for example, almost 6,000 dental visits, why are our local commercial dental offices not providing those services? Why? Because this is a huge operation. I mean, with the number of contacts you've demonstrated, and I can understand kind of the public health side of it as far as getting out and doing inspections and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But the interactions that pertain to dental and medical and shots and so forth, why is the private sector not handling that?
So just to speak from the dental perspective, we have an incredible pediatric dentistry group here in Alamance County. And we just have a lot of children with needs. So our children's dental clinic sees 0 to 21. We don't see adults. We see a large Medicaid population. We see a lot of folks, a lot of children who are also private insurance. So we run just like a private.
So are you getting those because commercial dentists don't want Medicaid patients?
No. A lot of our private dental practices take Medicaid patients. Absolutely. We just have a lot of children with dental needs.
So these are people that are beyond the capacity of the commercial group.
So I would say it's probably a multifaceted in that our private dentists are just like us. They have a set number of staff, they have a set number of chairs, and they can, once those are full, it's hard to keep bringing in new patients. We run into that same problem too. We have a nice dental, children's dental community that takes a lot of Medicaid patients. We just have a lot of children who need dental. What you find when you look at sort of research, that we're more likely to take care of our children than we are to take care of ourselves as adults. So it's more likely the compliance rates for children is much higher. So we're just seeing that some of our children's dental, private children's dental folks are taking Medicaid. They reach their capacity maybe for patient volume, and we see those folks too. But we also see a large amount of self-pay and private pay. And
are the dentists employed by the state or the county?
Our dentist?
Yeah.
By the county.
By the county.
So. There is a state employed dental hygienist for the region who helps support fluoride and some screenings in the schools at certain grade levels. But our dentists and our dental assistants are employed by the county. But I will say our children's dental clinic actually takes no county appropriated dollars. They operate on their own revenue and are self-sustainable. They do not take any tax dollars for their operation.
Casey, do you have any specific programs that address elder care in the department?
Not in our department. I will say that some of our like immunizations and those types of services are available to any age group. Kelly will likely talk to you about sort of what DSS does for elder care and how they're involved in that piece. But we don't do any primary care at our health department, which is where we would capture some of those folks and capture some of those adults. We don't do primary care at our health department. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I was curious, why do you not require hot water to be in the restrooms in the schools?
That is a great question. I do not know the answer to that question.
I know we deal with a lot of issues with...
Just can't hear you.
We deal with a lot of issues in the school system, like the pertussis issue, mm-hmm. and just whenever there's a virus going around, it just goes around quickly. And I just noticed that in a lot of our schools, we don't have hot water, and I think it's primarily a cost issue. But I would think that the health department would be able to require the schools to have hot water.
You mean as part of your inspection? Mm-hmm. So the health department is likely only inspecting the food service piece of that. And I will go back and ask environmental health if that is something that comes up in their inspections. I would just say as far as hygiene and
disease prevention is concerned, really it's the, so antibacterial kind of stuff that is actually the part. So water is needed to make that reaction happen. I don't know that it's hot water that is necessary for that, but I can ask Environmental Health for sure.
Any other questions?
Are these confirmed cases of STD individuals?
No, these are just visits.
Oh, okay.
So folks who come in, for whatever reason, if they're having symptoms that end up not being an STD, it could be some other medical ailment.
Just a concern and it's not...
Just a concern, that's correct. No, those are just total visits.
Stacy, thank you. We appreciate it. And Stacy does have to run, and we really do appreciate her time being here today. Next, I want to introduce Sheriff Terry Johnson. Sheriff Johnson has been sheriff for the Alamance County 14 years, and in the middle of his fourth term.
Yes.
And former SBI regional director, you name it, the sheriff has done it. But we appreciate the work that the sheriff does here for the citizens of Alamance County. So I'll turn it over to the sheriff.
Thank you. Not right now. You don't have to right now. Folks, the Alamance County Sheriff's Department is a multifaceted organization in that we're not like a police department. The Alamance County Sheriff's Office, any sheriff's department, has to run the court, security, has to transport inmates to and from prison, do the courthouse security at the door. We serve all the civil papers that's issued in the county. Believe me, that's a bunch of them. And we have to do patrol investigations out in the county. We also run a detention center. Our detention center, the one downtown here, holds 396 inmates. When we had the old prison unit open, it held an additional, so, and when we have them all full, you're looking at 496 inmates. And I'm telling you, that's babysitting 24/7 496 kids. So that's about what it's like. But the sheriffs in our state all have to do that. It's, in the state of Virginia, for instance, they have city sheriffs and county sheriffs, city jails and county jails. And it's not that way in North Carolina. But let's get started. We're going to talk about our personnel and training now. What we do and how we do it. We employ 122 sworn officers, 126 detention officers, and 17 civilians. Now, by national standards, our sheriff's office should have, they say 2.7 officers per 1,000 population is national standard, which means we should have 153 officers, but we do not. And I would like to slap my people on the back because they are doing the job pretty well with what we got. Sworn officers that get the training must complete 620-hour course known as the Basic Law Enforcement Training in order to become a certified BLET certified officer. That is recognized statewide. They go through BLET here, they leave the sheriff's department, they can go anywhere in the state because they've had this training. Same situation with our detention officers. They have to have 170 contact hours through a course known as Basic Detention Officer Training. And believe me, both of these courses are fairly tough courses. And give you an example, I think we started, I say we, the ACC runs our training. They started the last class, I think, for like 15 or 16 officers, and I think it's down to 8 now. It's very physically tough training. Additional sworn officers are required to complete 24 hours of annual in-service training every year. Some topics are state mandated, and I can, the agency heads can select 20, remaining 8 hours, or 4 hours, excuse me, of anything that he thinks his department needs. For instance, if I got a bunch of new officers and I don't think their report writing is what they should be, I can make it mandatory that they have to do that in the in-service training. Attention officers are only required to complete 16 hours of in-service training. Okay. By statute, all North Carolina sheriffs are responsible for maintaining a detention center, as I explained to you earlier. The service of all civil process, lawsuits, executions, evicting people out of houses when they're not paying their rent, and providing bails in the courtroom. We also handle the sex offender registration here. And I think we have a little over, I think around 300 registered sex offenders. We have to check on, we're checking on them monthly. Make sure they're where they say they're living. Make sure they're employed where they say they're employed. And usually, I'd say we probably arrest 2 a week for not fulfilling their obligation that they're supposed to fill. We also issue our gun purchase permits and carry and conceal weapon permitting. And I'm telling you right now, I've never seen nothing like it in the last year and a half in Alamance County. I probably signed 160, I would say, carry and conceal weapons in every week or every week and a half. And what has been surprising to me is that majority of them now are women. Are women. And it's really strange because all you ever seen was males applying for them. Also, we have deputies that serve all the child support papers that are issued by the courts for people non-support, and an officer dedicated to Human Services Center, which is Department of Social Service and our Health Department. Because I'm telling you, you would be surprised some of the characters that show up to that office. Matter of fact, I went over one day during Christmas, played Santa Claus a couple years ago, and wound up in a fight because the guy wanted his food stamps and he didn't want to wait the period he has to get them, and basically keep the door open to one of the social services people's thing. We also...
Were you dressed as Santa Claus?
Well, I had the toys taken over, and we wound up fighting in the floor.
It was right funny.
And it was then that our county manager decided maybe we need to put a deputy over our full time. And we did. Okay, we have four positions in animal control that picks up all the animals around in the county, not necessarily in all the cities, but some of the cities. We have three officers assigned to the federal task forces, Drug Enforcement Administration, U.S. Marshal Service, and the FBI Gang Task Force. And I know y'all saying, well, why do y'all have people assigned to these federal agencies? Let me tell you something. Drugs do not know county line boundaries. The gangs do not know county line boundaries. What goes on in Guilford County comes to Alamance County, vice versa. Our U.S. Marshal Service, it is a fugitive task force. We hunt fugitives down. For instance, there have been several situations. I know recently we had a guy walk out of court during a trial and didn't come back in court. Well, all we got to do is contact our guy with the Marshal Task Force. They find them. And believe me, they find them. They're very good at it. What do we do and what does it cost? Of course, the 2016-2017 budget request is approximately $21.2 million. Now, look at it. He done had a heart attack. See, we do not handle, what I'm saying, I don't have the figures that the county does on our salaries, so I have to estimate the upcoming budget and what I'm asking for, which he may choose to cut out some of that budget or the commissioners, which if they do, it's fine. But our sheriff's portion this year was $10.6 million. That's on the operations side, which is our patrol deputies that work outside, then our jail portion, $9.6 million. Starting salary for our Deputy 1 and Attention Officer 1 is $33,420 minus their benefits. Equipment cost, every new deputy is used around $6,734.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, Terry. Explain what you mean minus the benefits.
Okay, they get health insurance. That's not figured in that salary. Okay. They get retirement.
Benefits from that.
Right. Equipment cost, it cost us about $6,734 by the uniforms, holsters, the tasers, the firearms, etc. For the deputies, detention is a lot less because they don't carry the firearms, the shotguns, rifles, etc. Vehicle costs, we can purchase vehicle somewhere around $19,000 by the time we fully equip that vehicle with cage lights, cameras. We have cameras in our cars, we have computers in our cars, you're looking right at $42,000. The highest jail expenses, I can tell you, we spend close to $1 million every year on food and medical for inmates. It's amazing the medical problems that inmates come in to our jail. And we're working right now with the county to, we have a lot of people that I don't personally don't believe would be in that jail if they were getting their mental health medication and doctors, I'm telling you. And those people wind up hurting themselves or getting hurt in jail or coming in sick in jail, and it's costing the taxpayers a ton of money. Believe me, a ton. What we do, fire division, patrol division, we're responsible for 435 square miles of county jurisdiction. That's divided up into six districts. Now, we have 11 patrol officers on a shift to work 12-hour shifts. On any given day, one may be on vacation, one may be sick, one may be in court or in school. We have 7 or 8 officers patrol the entire county. And it makes it tough. I'll be honest with you, it makes it very tough to cover those miles because I expect my cars to keep going. We try to put the same people in the same district so they'll know the people in that district. They know when they work, they know what cars they drive, and if they see a strange car in the driveway at that house, they know it's supposed to be a Cadillac and it's a Volkswagen, they're going to pull in, make sure everything's okay. They also know, we have a system where they, when they go on vacation, they can say, hey, I want an officer checking my house. It's entered into a central communications computer. It pops up, they dispatch that deputy, you know, check that particular house, etc. Criminal Investigation Division, this is follow-up on crimes against persons and properties, homicides, rape, anything you name as a criminal violation. Civil response, serving all civil actions against persons and businesses. Let me get back to Criminal Investigation, man. We also have what we call an ANET unit that's made up of all departments in the county. We staff it, the most staff, which is our Alabama Narcotic Enforcement Team. It's run by one of our lieutenants. Crime scenes, process all crime scenes to cover and secure evidence. Let me tell you something, it's not quite like it shows on TV. Within an hour, you got people in jail, or you've got DNA done, and all. It don't happen that way, folks. And we have a crime scene unit that handles all the crime scenes. Special services, this is responsible for security of individual courtrooms and courthouses, animal services, Department of Social Services and Health Department, and emergency management. And that's what those individuals are inside those units. Special victims. This is crimes committed by and against juveniles, elder abuse, sex offender registration, and human trafficking. Domestic violence is a big thing here. Y'all would not believe the amount of domestic violence calls we have in this county. That's why we have the Family Justice Center and our... A lot of our special victims unit people work out of the Family Justice Center. Administration and Community Services. This is where it looks after all the records, public information, when the media starts calling, school resource officers, and our community outreach programs. How do we give back to the community? We develop a Citizens Academy. We're running the third one right now. If you've never attended our Citizens Academy, I highly recommend you do it. I think it's like 6 Tuesday nights, and the last night is graduation. You will be learning at that Citizens Academy everything the Sheriff's Department does, plus you will learn how to drive a sheriff's car. You will learn what we call a fax machine, shooting, the pistol, the do's and don'ts. And I'm sure you, when you go through it, you'll probably get killed or you'll kill an innocent citizen. It will give you a different perspective on our law enforcement and what really goes on. Safe street driving programmer, DA and us team together, kid gets a ticket, his first ticket, if he'll go through that road, they'll dismiss it one time. So I think that's a packing patrol car, food drive, we do that to with allied churches. We developed a watch program, special Olympics. We also started in our jail the GED program where inmates that's in there 180 days at least could go through the schooling. We paired with ACC, and we just had two of our people to graduate from GED program in jail. Why are you doing that, sir? Well, I'll tell you why we're doing it. Person goes in that jail, sits around, does nothing, comes out, wants a job. He hasn't done anything. Nobody's going to hire him. But if he shows he used that time in that jail to get his education, it shows, hey, he wants to change his or her life. Drug drop box, where if you got old medication, you can come pour it in to our drop box, then it's effectively destroyed. Crime Stoppers, which is we partner with Burlington, and that's where you call in, give information, not have to give your name, and even get some money if it's correct. We do our vacation checks that I was telling you about, and certainly our drug abuse resistance education program. Okay, on this particular thing, or this was a true case, just recently happened. Early morning of March 5th, 2015 at 2:12 a.m., one of our patrol deputies was patrolling at Lamb's Chapel, around Lamb's Chapel Church, spotted a yellow dump truck, flatbed dump truck with no lights on. He stops that vehicle, and you know, night, you're going to be driving lights unless you have something bad. Stops that particular vehicle, gets out, walks up, approaches the vehicle, sees that the two occupant and driver got a beer light. He asks them to step out. Guy throws it, drive, takes off. Of course, unbeknownst to him at that time, the guy that was driving that truck had a record. You can hang on the wall, you can bet they were up to something bad. The officer chased them all over Hall River, up 70, into Burlington, calling for help. Well, when you are in the county, I'm just telling you, the closest car, when calls are not going on, is probably 15 miles from you in another district. So this chase took us into the city of Burlington. And at this time, I'm going to show you Chase, and I'm going to finish with a little bit of that for good. You will see that they shot one of our deputies' cars all to pieces. That is a fact. Those are warrants all over the ground. Officer Fiola, he just went to start going out there and got the cover, and they jumped up, and crashed his deputies. The SUV was not seriously hurt, if you believe that, because he had a vest on and an airbag. He was a K-9 car. Why did that happen? Tell you why it happened. And I'm not asking other people, sir, so don't play. But once again, he had run that guy. People were trying to get to him. He finally pulled over on, I can't remember, I got down here, the street. Near Beaumont Street, where that wreck happened. The officer gets out of his car, guy comes out of the dump truck with a gun and shoots his car off base, trying to kill the deputy. Deputy dives down, they jump back in the truck, he jumps back in the truck, takes off. That's where the chase started, and the officers, the last communication with the officer being shot at was, "I need help." And so the officer that got hit was responding to try to get to him. And then the car chasing was trying, the time he went through one intersection, so you know, he was already through another one, but time dispatch got it, and the officer over the radio, and that's what happened. The officer was okay, threw one of the occupants out of the dump truck, and the other guy is in jail, AN-45, driving left center failure, operate without lights, failing to stop a blue light siren, driving with lights revoked, reckless driving, failing, fleeing, and losing red. Carrying a concealed weapon, possessed firearm by a convicted felon, discharging a firearm in the city, discharging a weapon into an occupied vehicle, and attempted murder, first degree, murder of an officer.
Now he's still in jail.
He better be, or me and Dad ain't gonna lock on. Okay. But he had a record, and the honest thing about it, he should have never been on the street to start with if you look at his record. Okay, this is our Alamance Narcotics Unit. This is recently, y'all seen in the paper about approximately $1.47 million in cash seized. This is 15 kilos of cocaine that was seized involving that operation. And just show you some of the things. And there's right at $1.5 million in cash. Drug cartel. Nobody wants to believe it's here in Alamance County. Drug cartel.
This was the one in Harbor River?
Yes, sir. That's all money wrapped. So these are just some things we do.
Thank you.
If you have any questions, I'd be willing to answer any question you have.
Was that video made from a store video?
Yes, sir. The interesting thing, he thinks it's going to be a budget. The camera in the car is so old, it wasn't working. The officer chasing to get you. I wished it had been. We had to get the store video to show.
And was that the police, Burlington Police Department there?
No, sir. That was us.
No police got to it.
No, sir. They see. Now, once again, sometimes CCOM has to notify Burlington, and they have to switch over to be able to monitor. What I would love to see for this county, and is one central communication system with all law enforcement on the same channel screen.
So what's keeping us from doing that?
We're working on that now. We do provide for everybody except the city of Burlington. And sometimes there is a control issue.
All they do is you come on right now and chat Burlington.
Yeah, sometimes it's a control issue. They feel like that they have more input on their officers. So we've had preliminary discussions in the past. It is one of those things that there needs to be a champion that we get behind so we can move that idea forward.
But if you call them, they can then communicate directly with your cars.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
But
all calls also come to Alamance County first.
Yeah.
And then we will dispatch it if the city of Burlington fire or police will send it to the city of Burlington.
Okay.
The money that you spend on health services and prisons, does the county ever recoup any of that money?
We recoup if they are state misdemeanors sent here by another court from another county. We hold them, but we do hold state misdemeanors from other agencies or other counties to make money for the county. We get paid $40 per inmate if we hold those, and then the state sheriff's association pays their medical, if they have to go to the hospital. You say, well, why are you holding those prisoners? Because if I don't hold those inmates, then every inmate misdemeanor that's sentenced here in Alamance County, state won't give us a dime for keeping them.
That makes sense.
And we do. We try to make money. I've always said that. We also hold U.S. Marshal prisoners here. But our inmates we have here that we arrest here in Alamance County in jail, if they are medical, we eat that bill.
Harry, is our county pretty typical of all the other counties? Or let's say if you group the counties of Hickory and Salisbury, towns that are some counties that are somewhat similar, let's say 10 or 12 of them, are the numbers about the same? Are we unique because we're on the two interstates?
We are definitely, the clientele we're getting, we are unique because we're along the interstate. Okay. That's why your major drug trafficking organizations are trying to sell right here. We've got two major interstates, one run north-south, run east-west, that goes county line to county line. We also, and this is what it said, we put heat on the drug traffickers on the interstate, they go to the secondary roads. You've got 62, 49, 54, 87, 61, 70. They go anywhere in southeastern United States. That's what makes it so beautiful for the drug trafficker, I reckon. We're known by Drug Enforcement Administration as Drug Hub of the Southeastern United States. Mm-hmm. That's what they know.
But beyond just the drug component of it, are our sheriff's department's operations pretty much like the rest of the state?
Yes, sir, it is. I'll be honest with you. I think probably a sheriff in my administration will be a whole lot more stricter than some of these other sheriff's agencies.
And I think what you're looking for about the number of officers, we're probably at the midpoint or below side with respect to the number of officers. And
I think we are. I'd love to be Sheriff Barnes and have what he has here, but we don't have that, you know. But as far as side, I'd say mid to lower level, but I think my people are pretty efficient up there. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
And did I read right in the paper several weeks back that federal authorities are holding money back from you for?
Let me tell you, doggone right, they hold the money back. Money that is asset forfeiture, but they have been ordered to release it. And if it ain't here by the 15th, you can bet I'm going to be in touch with Washington, D.C. through our congressman or our senator. But they say initially they owe us only $350,000. I have paperwork that shows us they owe us about $2.5 million.
So, we'll see what
that
is. Hey, is that Washington math?
And let me say this. Prior to them stopping, giving us our forfeiture money, and county manager tell you, I bought a lot of vehicles so the taxpayers wouldn't, out of that money, that the taxpayers wouldn't have to do it to try to get our fleet up to par. Another one along. Yes, sir.
Max, this question.
Yes, sir.
For your new budget, do you put money in for your new officers?
For new officers?
Yes.
I have asked for five new officers. I know I probably won't get all of them, but I think if we can, I think our management, and I've got a real good working relationship with our county manager and our county commissioners to a certain extent. But I get along with him good.
Thank you. All right, Sheriff, thank you. We appreciate you. And again, we appreciate the sheriff and also we do a variety of things, and that's one of the things that we wanted to make sure that you had opportunity to see. Next, I'm going to introduce Kelly Edmond. Kelly serves as a assistant director of our Department of Social Services. Kelly just got promoted. In the last 30 days?
No, January 1st.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's been a while now.
But Kelly's been with us about 4 years?
Just over two.
Oh my gosh.
It's a long time.
But we really do appreciate the work Kelly has done, and Kelly will kind of give you an update of a lot of the different programs at Social Services.
Absolutely. Let's get my presentation pulled up here. But just to introduce myself, my name again is Kelly Edmond, and I'm assistant director, and that means that I am in charge of the easy stuff at Social Services,
right,
like the human resources and the computer systems and the budget, not the hard stuff of the adult protective services, child welfare, economic services, those kinds of things. So we really do have a great team, and I'm really excited to be about it, and part of it. And I'm one of those lucky people who I work in the building that I was born. How many people can say that? So it's the old Alamance County Hospital is where we are with the health department. And yes, I grew up in a lower Alamance. We like to call it LA, right? So it's fun to be back. My family, we just moved here from Ashboro about 6 months ago. I've been commuting before, and it's just great to be back in Alamance County and doing this great work. We can be a little bit interactive if you'd like, but tell me what you think about when you think of social services. What first comes to mind when you think about social services?
Child protective services.
Absolutely. Child protection, child welfare is definitely a piece of it. Anything else that initially comes to mind? That's true. Social workers, we do employ social workers on the adult side and the child side of the house. We, Mr. Sproul mentioned, we have a program integrity department, so we investigate fraud across food, nutrition services, and Medicaid, and people are either disqualified from receiving, been or asked to pay those monies back if they get them fraudulently. So just to give you a list of some DSS services, again, food and nutrition is a big part of what we do, and we determine eligibility for people to get food stamps and to get Medicaid. That is a big part of what we do every day. The child support office works at DSS. So, and that is establishing those child support claims through DNA, and also enforcing that people are paid, that parents get their money for their children every month. We also act as a first responder. As many of you mentioned, the Adult Protective Services, Child Protective Services, we're on call. Sometimes we get those calls with the Sheriff's Department in the middle of the night. We had one a couple months ago that was a mobile meth lab that was being transported through our county, and there was a four-year-old child in the vehicle. So parents were, of course, apprehended, and so we get the call to, number one, be there, and the child had to be decontaminated because he'd been exposed to those surroundings, and then also to help get him back to a kinship placement. So we do consider ourselves first responders in that regard. And then disaster services. We are mandated, the Department of Social Services, to staff Red Cross shelters during times of emergency. So that could be the big ice storm we had a couple years ago, or it could be an apartment fire. But everybody knows when they sign up with social services that you could be called on to help staff a clinic.
Do you have the Red Cross training for that?
We are mainly in charge of just setting up the facility and helping with meals and things like that. So we do some trainings about twice a year with our staff, just so they know that they're comfortable. I think we've only deployed maybe once in the last 10 years. So we'll knock on wood. We don't want any more disasters for anybody. Also, employment services and daycare assistance is a part of our work. And we are unique in that our DSS office has the Family Justice Center. And we have a real focus on helping people who are victims of domestic violence, helping them obtain services. We're unique in that we have the 50B, electronic 50B program out of our Family Justice Center that has been nationally recognized. So it's really neat to be part of such innovation within our work. So any questions about DSS services provided? Non-emergency Medicaid transportation is also something that we do. So these are just some of them, but there are 28 federally and state mandated programs that we are responsible to administer. And so when you look at our budget, we have about a $23.5 million budget, but we get $17 million in revenue back from the federal government or the state government. So the county dollars is about $6.4 million. Is that the only portion that's county dollars? So that equates out to 27 to 28% of our budget coming from county funds. So just before we move forward, you know, I've got our mission here, but we really think our purpose in the community is to enhance lives, and we really think of ourselves as a community partner. And I think about how closely we work with our community partners, and I think about the school board for one. You know, if you think about trying to educate a child who, and you know, if you're a parent, you know, you get that reading folder home every night, you've got that 30 minutes of reading that you want to do with your child. Well, what about that parent who doesn't know where supper's coming from? They might be planning on sleeping in their car. So, I mean, you think about the overflow of the work we do and making sure that people have, they have food resources, they have energy, that their lights are on, that they hopefully have a safe place to live, and how that trickles down into our education system and just our community at large. And then who are those children who maybe are the victims of abuse and neglect, and what are the services that they need throughout their lives to make them sufficient and parts of our community, and that they can really heal from that and then and move on to be productive citizens. So that's really what we see our role as. I think, Tori, were there handouts to Susan? Okay, they're up here if anybody would like them. But we have our annual report up here, and also a little flyer that's called A Day in the Life of DSS that is kind of interesting. But this is just our monthly dashboard, and these are just some of the things that we track along with our board. The number of children in foster care. So that was, you know, one point in time at 113. We're currently at 108. We just had about 10 adoptions, so that's kind of coming down for us. But that is a number that we're seeing growing in our community. And we have a goal this coming year to train 30 new foster parents in our community. So we're lucky that we have people who are willing to step up and provide that service. Also, with adoptions completed, about 1,200 families received daycare assistance. In any given month, we'll see about 58 people at the Family Justice Center. So that would be somebody who was coming in because of a domestic violence situation. Adult Protective Services reports, about 50 in any given month. And something that we're really seeing some growth in now is guardianship. So normally, let's see, about September, we had about 80 guardians. We would normally see about maybe 35 new guardianship situations in a year. Well, we've already seen 70 new guardian situations this year. So that's just an area that is growing. And that would be adults that are deemed incompetent to make their financial decisions for them, and we assume that responsibility for them and help them pay their rent, make sure that their medical care is taken care of, that they have transportation, just basically all their activities of daily living, things like that. So this is a report that we publish monthly. You can see what our Medicaid recipients for the whole county, a little over 23,000. Health Choice for children, about 2,800 recipients. And Work First Family Assistance, these are a little bit over 500. That would be what you would traditionally think of as the welfare check. And you see that's such a very small part of what we do, is actually that traditional, it's called a Work First check, and it's time limited. And then families receiving food stamps, about 12,000 on any given month.
You work closely with churches?
We do refer, elaborate on that a little bit. What do we work with churches
churches fulfill a lot of these needs.
You are right, they do. And we refer. And
it would seem that, you know, that if the churches and your department knew what each other was doing.
Absolutely. We have an amazing resource in our county employees and beyond of when we have a need, that we'll put it out on email. And, you know, sometimes we have need for beds, or a family has just moved and they don't have any towels or clothes for a certain size of child. And it's amazing how quickly, either within our church communities or within our county employee communities, about how quickly people will meet those needs. And so I do feel like, well, it's not really formal. We have a very good informal system of and food banks. We know which churches offer food banks, and you know, there is a waiting period between you when you sign up for food stamps and you're eligible to receive them, that help bridge that gap. So that is an absolutely wonderful resource. Yes.
Is the food stamp money state money, federal money?
It's federal money.
So nothing from the county or the city goes into the...
Right. Just the administration of the program. Now that, when we determine eligibility, now that's a 50-50 split with the county and the federal government for the administration of the food stamp program. And then the Medicaid program is 75% federal and 25% county.
What about helping adults in seeking jobs? There's an organization called Dress for Success. Have mm-hmm. you ever heard of that?
Yes, absolutely.
And you know, a lot of people just are pretty clueless about going after a job, how to approach it, and so on. And
absolutely.
Some training in that
that's
is very effective.
Absolutely, and that's what our Work First program does, is it helps people who are just entering the job force, or maybe they're coming back, maybe they've been incarcerated for some period of time, and helping them get their resume together. What's their experience? Help them get their GED. Help them get the computer skills that they need to be marketable in society. So that's a big part of what we do.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Do you have to give the federal government the amount that you needed for the food stamps, or they give you a certain budget for that?
Well, it's dependent on people who are eligible who apply within
Alameda County. So you count the number of people that would be needing
We turn assistance. In, we fill out their application within, it's called NCFAS, and that application is submitted, and then the federal government would put, people get EBT cards that have their benefit on it, and that's directly loaded onto their card. So, and I think that's about $3 million a month for Alamance County recipients, or the food stamp benefit.
Has it ticked up recently, or is it?
We have seen growth in our food stamp and our Medicaid population, pretty exponential growth over the last couple of years. Okay, and then again, just what is a week in the life of DSS? And I won't read this to you, but just so pull out a couple highlights. Just so you understand the nature of the work. But a three-month-old child born drug positive, the mother relapsed, the kinship placement can no longer take care of the baby. There are no appropriate family members to take over, so this child becomes in DSS custody. There's a domestic violence case initiated, and a worker goes out with the police department until 2 a.m. We have an attorney and a program manager in the office to help figure out the custody paperwork. Also, APS reports. We'll get calls from the hospital to say that someone has come in, maybe they're disoriented, they don't know where they live, and can we help them locate their next of kin. And as Sheriff Johnson mentioned, mental health is a big concern for us as well. And we deal with a lot of families who are in need of mental health services. When people come to our office, and then we also go out to them. In closing, the last thing that I would say is, and as you're leaving today, be sure and go around the courthouse. At noon today, we had a ceremony for April being Child Abuse Prevention Month. And so you'll see the pinwheels that are on the lawn around the courthouse, and just use April to help us get the word out about how important it is to remember our children and to prevent abuse. It's 100% preventable.
And it'll be, the courthouse will be lit.
That's right. It's so neat. We're excited. Tonight the courthouse will be lit in blue. Blue is the color of child abuse prevention, and so the courthouse will be lit in blue tonight. So there, you'll see the pinwheels. I think there's 200. There are 24 that have white ribbons on them, and that represents the 24 child fatalities in North Carolina last year due to child abuse. So, any
How
other
many
questions?
Last year?
24 in the state of North Carolina.
Oh, okay.
If it sounds like what, based on what you've said and what the sheriff said, that the way we're mishandling the mental health issue is a big deal. From where you sit, what would be the right way to do that?
Wow, that's a really tough question.
And
I wouldn't say I would say mishandled. I would just say that it is a growing problem, and how we deal with that and how you address it. I'll tell you, we are asked permission from the commissioners this week to apply for a grant from the Department of Health and Human Services, and it's all about prevention, because there are cases that we screen out and we say, no, there's not any child abuse, there's no neglect or abuse or dependency, but this family is at risk.
Yeah.
And what can we do to make sure it doesn't go any further? And so we're really excited about trying to prevent some of that, and that might be through making sure people are following up with their mental health.
And if I could also say, the state of North Carolina has been going through mental health reform for the last 15, 20 years. Mm-hmm. They still don't have it right. So they're still trying to decide what is the best way.
Yeah.
But it is a growing concern. The numbers are growing on a daily basis. And again, it's a call for our schools. It's a call for our jails. It's a call for social services, and really for those that can't be employed. And I think we are very, very proud of the work that we're doing with the Stepping Up Initiative at the jails. Mm-hmm.
very proud of what we're doing with Cardinal Innovations and very proud of what the schools are doing as well, but we're trying. But do we have a good handle on it? No, not at this point. But I think there's a lot of effort, a lot of energy that is being put towards mental health.
Well, in your role over the county now, I mean over the state, throughout the state, you probably can hear from what some of the other counties are doing. And then our state should be hearing what, for example, what they're doing in Minnesota or other states. And because it has presented itself in almost every mass shooting that we've had, too.
Very true.
Any other questions?
Yeah, concerning Child Protective Services, one thing that has always been a concern of mine, because I've heard of instances many times, is where it turns out that the whoever comes in, let's say between a child and the parent, it ends up enabling the child, you know, in their negative behavior, because the child now becomes aware that they can, all they have to do is say to somebody in social services that dad did this, you know, maybe just gave him a spank on the butt or something, and it messes up the relationship that a parent and a child should have.
Right.
And I'm just wondering what you have to say about that. Sometimes it seems like there's somebody in the agency that just wants to exhibit their power that they have over the family, over the parents.
I can assure you that family preservation is always our first goal. We want to give that family the skills that they need to be successful. And our social workers are really trained in recognizing when is it real and when is it attention seeking or you know, if it's not legitimate. So we take that work very seriously and try to be a family partner in getting to a solution that is better for everyone, as opposed to trying to mess with the family dynamics. So I don't know if that answers your question. That's a tough one.
All right, Kelly, thank you. We do appreciate
Thanks.
I enjoyed it. Thank you so much. Next, and I know we're running just a little late, and again, I didn't judge time well, so it's not their fault, it's my fault. But I'm going to introduce Libby Hodges. Libby is our planning director for Alamance County. Libby's been with us a year and...
Almost 2 years.
I'm going to get the time right sooner or later, but... Libby came to us from Durham County and the city of Durham, and Libby's done a wonderful job, and one of the big projects Libby is working on is our strategic plan, and this is something that we have not done in a while. We've done a Alamance 2020 plan that was, what, how many years?
2003,
13 years ago. So it was time to update that plan. We've had a bunch of input sessions that we have gone out to the fire departments and to civic centers, you name it. We have been out 17 times?
17 times.
17 times.
You're
so
taking my presentation.
I am, but with that said, I'll turn it over to you.
I'm going to talk quick. As through all of them, feel free to stop me if you have questions. So basically, in a nutshell, I'm going to go over what is the strategic plan. Well, it's a roadmap to help the county know what we're doing, where our resources are going, and to help us tap into what the public would like to see us do. Why we need a strategic plan is it helps us make decisions that reflect your values. This is a lot of text, but how we've basically gone about making the strategic plan as we've gone through this series of community forums, basically trying to solicit feedback. So we want you to tell us. I guess fortunately or unfortunately, we've concluded those So if this is the first time you're hearing about it, don't worry, we will probably have more opportunity for input in the future. So just keep your ears open. But we are currently working to assemble all of this information. The process so far, we talked about the Destination 2020 plan from 2003. We reviewed that plan. We had a commissioner's visioning retreat where we sat down with some of the commissioners and figured out what it is they wanted us to do with the strategic plan. We created an employee resource group that was intended to help with the forums and getting them trained on facilitation. We have naming contests. We're still working on that. We contact more than 150 private groups across the county to gauge their interest in participating in the plan. We've held 17 public forums across the county, mostly at the local fire departments, as Greg said. We've had more than 200 participants in this process. And here's a quick little map. We did this map. Every time we went out, it's difficult to see the difference between the stars and the dots on this particular map. The stars were the locations we held the forums, and the dots are where the participants live. I asked them to put a dot on the map for where you live, just to get a good idea of where folks were coming from. So in a nutshell, some of what we heard, and this isn't it by any measure, we have pages and pages and pages of feedback, but they were encouraged that we were reaching out to them to get their input. They were very glad that we have an active private, nonprofit, and religious community working to help the county government achieve some of its goals. There was some concern about schools, concern about good, affordable housing, concern about development and growth. They like that we are working hard to collaborate with our other governmental agencies that we work with, and folks love our parks and trails. So in a quick nutshell, that's just a few of the items that came up repeatedly during this process. So from here, what we're working to do is put all the responses together. We're going to finalize the naming contest. That should hopefully be coming up real soon. We're going to set up some time to coordinate with county commissioners to present the research and for their feedback. And then we're going to begin to draft an actual strategic plan. So that's the 10-second version of what we've been working on for the past 6 months?
Oh, more than that probably.
But it's been a while. Overall, more than that.
Yeah,
but we really hit the floor running about September of last year. So. Any questions? Comments?
And again, what we wanted Libby to do is just to introduce you to it. And again, we will put a lot of this information on our website. We'll put the presentations. We'll put the draft to allow you to have comment and input on it when we get to that point. Well, with that being said, this kind of concludes County Government 101. We really do appreciate your attendance and your input. We didn't know what to expect. If you see that we're having it next week, Monday night and Thursday night, it's the same thing that I did earlier. It'll be the same presentation we did today. We thought that, you know, by having one during the day and one at night, you may get a different group of people who could show up. So, but if you're bored, come out next week. We'll be glad to have you again. But we have pins. There's information up here that Tori printed off some of the budget sheets that we did. If you have any questions, you want to have a hard copy of some of this, please come and take. And we also have our county evaluation sheets. If you wouldn't mind filling those out. Again, this was the first time we tried something. So we may need to say we need to do this as a County Government 101 series like the Sheriff's Department did. So we can spend more time on what does planning do. We can spend the time specifically on social services and maybe take a tour. Those type things. We didn't even talk about the landfill hardly. So landfill is one of the biggest things that we do. Just let us know what you think. And again, we thank you for your participation and have a wonderful day.
One more time.
Yes.
Next Thursday.